We're off this morning, we're pleased to have Tanya Spencer, we're going to talk about limits of technical organizations for first boundary.
Thanks, Walt, thanks for the invitation. Yeah, so the talk is about technical geometry. If I don't hear me there, please tell me. So, okay, so S, the orientable surface. Genus G with n punctures. And I want genus 0, then sphere, it's a sphere of with at least 4 punctures. Genus 1, I want to have at least 1 puncture. Okay, and so I consider the diagonal space of that surface. So I'm not gonna really define anything. If you want the definition, I do. Okay, so diagonal space, and so we're good with diagonal measure. We know that the diagonal space is homeomorphic to a ball of dimension 6, g minus 6 plus 2n. And so there is a Thurston compactification. Projectivized measured foliations, which is topologically a sphere of dimension g minus 6, 6g minus 7 plus 2. Okay? So these are projectivized measured foliations. So I'm going to remind you in a second what it means for a sequence of points to converge to a class of metric foliation. So the question one would like to discuss is, I take a point in a tight space, and I take a quadratic differential. And so I consider an array based at x0 and defined by q. So there are 2 rays clearly, but so I take one where so the quadratic differential comes with a vertical and horizontal metric foliations on x0. So the array I consider is that the vertical foliation gets squeezed and the horizontal gets stretched. Consider a technical array. So based. And the question is, what is the behavior of this ray in the boundary, in the Thurston boundary? So, what I mean by that is, what can one say about the limit set of that ray? Set of accumulation points of that ray in the Yeah. Okay, so maybe that now it's a good time to remind you what it means for a sequence of points to converge to something in PMF. So if you just have a sequence of points, class of measured foliation. So if what one can think of is so you have a sequence, it goes to zero of numbers such that for any simple closed curve on S, the hyperbolic length of the geodesic in the class of alpha, so the in the hyperbolic structure of the of Xn, converges to the intersection of alpha with any, so you have to pick some representative.
I think you mean S sub n on the left.
Okay. So you want that? Well, and okay, so it is what one normally does is one has to be slightly careful. What one normally wants to do is to look at ratio of hyperbolic length of curves. Well, I mean, here you just have, we just have to be careful. I mean, if the intersection of I mean, if this curve does not intersect the foliation, it's not very good. I mean, this is what one normally wants to do. So what is the difficulty is that, I will slightly recall a bit later, but the Teichmann arrays are given by, so one deforms a flat metric, okay? So one takes some, flat surface, so a metric given by the quadratic differential, and then one deforms it, okay? Like one scales by e to the negative t vertically and by e to the t horizontally, something like that. So one knows how the flat metric changes. So in particular, one can compute the flat lengths of curves. But one does not know how. The game is to see how the hyperbolic length changes, how the hyperbolic structure changes along the ray. And so the main difficulty is that one doesn't have a different way to, one does not know precisely the way. So one has to kind of, this is the setup. I remind you briefly some history. In the 80s, early 80s, I'm sorry, year. The major proved the following that F would be the vertical foliation. the, so they have some quadratic differential that determines the radian. So I take its vertical measure correlation. So he proved that if that correlation is uniquely ergodic, so means that up to scale, the A takes the U is the only measure, invariant measure on F, then the corresponding array converges in PMF exactly to that, to the class of that magic foliation. And so all uniquely ergodic directions are generic, so and then also another situation, if the vertical correlation is such that the the trajectory is of the quadratic differential at all, so meaning that the complement of critical leaves of F is just a union of cylinders. So what kind of foliation is there? So, well, so the example was in genus 2. So the example was in genus 2. So I will, okay. So use this construction or generalization with construction later. So I will say more about it. But so basically the idea is that you. So you the correlation that so it, you have this so the quadratic differential has two zeros of order 2 here and here and then so here on the two tori the foliation is minimal. Okay, so here you have some irrational slope. and some irrational slope. And one and some irrational slope thing. Okay, and then so it's just enough for the rate to not converge. It's enough to say something about so theta 1 and theta 2. So if I write a continuous fraction expansion of theta 1, theta 2. So if the coefficients of theta 1, for example, are bounded, and the others are not, then the limit set is a second. So
what is the segment?
The segment is it's a subset, or maybe the whole thing of the one simplex, which is spanned by the foliation that is so all the weight has all the weight here, and the other foliation all the weight here.
Is there a condition on the AI and the BI which guarantees you get the whole thing?
So one can come up with that. Yeah, I didn't work that out. So but I. I don't know if, there is a condition, but I don't think it's very pretty, so it's not that like, simple as that. So. But yeah, I did not work that particularly. So I just showed that, so there's a, so in, a, yeah, so if you take it like that, it's set up like that, so that the AIs are abounded and BIs are not, then what you get is the foliation. So the foliation here, so the foliation, so I will have the endpoint which is supported on the torus with slope theta 1. Okay, and then there will be also, yeah. So I definitely know that the left side is in the limit set, and the right side I don't know. So I think one has to put more conditions on AI and okay, so one can also do that with a. Sending, so one can also have the same thing by taking both AI and BI going to infinity, but coordinate them in some way so that you get the whole thing. So it's not a logical order because so this foliation, as you know, this is not minimal. So after the Mazur's result, so the question that one could ask is what happens if the foliation is minimal but not uniquely ergodic. So this is definitely not the case for that. So this foliation, in my example, is not minimal. Also, what happens if it is not minimal but also not a union of cylinders? So, this is the case. So there was also some results about minimal non-unique ergodic foliations, and I will also mention them in a little while. Okay, but now so then there was a question. So one can see that one can, so the limit is is a segment. So the natural question to, I think, our major asked was, well, can you get a more a geodesic, can you find a tangular geodesic ray with limits at two-dimensional, three-dimensional? Okay, so okay, so the yeah, so the answer is yes. So this is joint work with Lava Pinani and Azarafi. So it's very recent. So following, so for any, so here I don't fix the surface, you know, I did not fix the topology of the surface. For any D, so I guess one can also use one here, but go on if it's known. So there. There is a tangular geodesic. And then here, so now I complete plus and minus, plus and minus. minus, so, so I cut the whole thing, and then I, the, I'm going to identify the plus of T1 with a minus of T2, and so on. So we'll do by translation. I minus of the I plus one, not the mod E plus one. Okay, so what that gives you is a surface of genus D. By these D plus one ergodic measures. So that's the term. So so I'd like to maybe try to give you an idea of how does things like that.
Can you say something about the continuous functionality?
So they are basically one, so, sorry, what was the question?
So what are the continuous functionalities of this data?
Yeah, so, yes. Yeah, that's the theorem.
I understand, you can describe, like before I said one is bounded, one is unbounded, so here is not
the yeah, so the, so the, so I will tell you what,
okay.
How one should
okay.
Be. So, yeah, so the idea is the following, so you start by fixing a countable set, a countable, set of triples. So that so I want that projected to the so that set becomes dense. I want this to be dense in a R plus P. And so the idea is that I want to it to yeah. Why did I say 3? Because my D is 2 from now on. I mean, it is the same, but it's just less to like. Gamma and gamma prime, simple closed curves. So where one has to be slightly careful, but so the ratio of the their hyperbolic lengths at these times. So this is a hyperbolic length of the x tn. Gamma over gamma prime, but that is asymptotic. To the sum of
so this U's are the entries of the continuous function of the tree no.
No, this is I just take something and here's the intersection of the gamma with I okay over the intersection gamma prime. So this is what you want, yeah. Okay, so if you have that, then you're happy.
Why do you have it? J. No, gamma is not
nice. So because that tells me that I get close to any point in the simplex.
We may have this one.
I have a. See, so I basically took a dense set there.
You just have a sum above.
So
and your TN will not depend on the curves?
At the end, what depends? So the right, so you want this, then the okay. So as I mentioned, so we don't have a very precise way to compute the length of hyperbolic length of curves. Okay, no, it's just the flat metric. So I give you some. So there's a. So one way to estimate is to use short curves. Like if you know all the short curves of your surface, you know, meaning that okay, you also know how much you intersect them, stuff like that. So then you can give some estimate. Okay, so I will write that estimate. So if you have just gamma a curve. And alpha, a short curve. I mean, OK, so you can define it for any curve. But, so it does not make a lot of sense to define it for when alpha is 1. So you define the following thing. So it's a contribution that alpha makes to the hyperbolic length of gamma. OK, so x, so we have x on. Going to take more space. So the contribution of alpha right, to the length of gamma is defined by, so I will explain what these are. So it's width of alpha from x plus the hyperbolic length of alpha from x plus the twist. So many times gamma twists around alpha, okay. And all you so this quantity is so imagine alpha is short, and then you have an arc of gamma that so you just look at so basically this is the price gamma pays every time it crosses alpha. So I'm gonna multiply it by the intersection number of gamma with alpha. So this is the size of the color provided by the color gamma. Size of the color around alpha. So we know exactly what it is from the color gamma. Okay. So this is yeah. So you imagine that you know what this is, so the length of short curve. And then, okay, so this is the just every time. So here's alpha. So gamma, like an arc of gamma comes close to the geodesic representative of alpha, and then twists some more, and comes up. So this is the end of the twisting number. So I'm not going to talk about how it is defined. Very important. Okay, so this is the so one just computes the so it's one takes the length of this arc and multiplies by the so this is the contribution and here and so so this is just one curve, but now imagine that you have a you know like the all the short curves. So you have a short fancy composition. So P is a short fancy composition. Then so the result of choice roughly Carnot series. So what they tell us is that the difference, so the error between the length of gamma and the sum over all the curves in the fancy composition of these contributions like the intersection with of gamma with a short band decomposition. So, which can be very large, but if this quantity is huge, then the error does not. You're not very bothered by the error. So this is what you want to do. And well, that's basically the only tool I know. Okay, so that to identify short curves, just try to find the, because a computer length of short curve is easier than this length of curve. Well, so let's say one knows the length of the short curves, then one has a pretty good estimate. So in our case, we know exactly the short curves. So in our case, we know exactly the short curves. So basically, what is the situation? So if you think about the surface, so I have a three toroid group together. So basically there are these three separating curves, which are union of some critical heat. Okay, let's call them beta 1, beta 2, and beta 3. Okay, so their size goes to 0. Okay, so that goes to 0, so it's not very hard to see. So they're always short, and they just get shorter. So the hyperbolic length of along the adjacent ray goes to 0. One also knows how fast it goes to 0, so one has a complete control of that. And then, so basically, what you're left with is a free toroid, and you also know, so in the torus, it is very easy to compute which curves are short. Okay, so if you have a torus where the foliation has slope theta I, I'm just gonna write theta, okay? It's faithful to the indices. Then the short curves at all times. So at all times, there is a short curve, and that short curve is a curve whose slope is a convergent of theta. So they are curves alpha n, which are whose slope un pn curves.
In the torus, the short hyperbolic and short flat are the same thing somehow?
So I think that if the short curve it has length 1, then maybe you don't know exactly if it is. So it is. So, but if so, if it is, you know, if the yeah, if it is. I mean, so I think that I would not bet on it if. I mean, because you can have two short curves of length 1, for example, like that. Yeah, and then so I don't know which one. I mean, if they're the same, or if like one is slightly bigger than the other, like which one will win in the hyperbolic metric. I don't know. That I don't. But I don't care about that. So because I only care when curves are really short. So when the curve is really short, there is no doubt that it is the shortest in the hyperbolic metric. Okay. So what I meant by PN and QN is that so if the theta is the has continued fraction expansion like that with coefficients a n, then pn over qn is just you stop after. So you just stop after n. So you know exactly what they are, and I will tell you even more. Close enough, okay? Close enough, so you can control. So you cannot make it the model at the same time, you won't get what you want. So, and so that the hyperbolic length of gamma at the time when they're balanced is just the sum of the width, which is the width I will not now tell you, it's just the log of 1 over the and the how many times gamma intersect these curves. Okay, so technically I should add the contributions from betas. So believe me, contributions from betas is not so it's not intersect because beta i's they go to zero kind of slowly. So compared to what happens on the toroid, it is much slower. So the because the yeah, so the here these numbers grow really, really, really fast. The intersection numbers grow really, really fast. And so the and by beta i is the same if you intersect the same number of times. So okay. So these are at times when at the time when all these three curves are sort of balanced. Another fact, because you are wondering where will the intersection with the foliation come up. So another fact that is not so easy, not so hard to.
I'm sorry, the beta i's, they do pinch, so they contribute to length, but just not.
Not very much. They don't get pinched fast enough because there's.
They do pinch, but not fast enough.
Yeah. Okay. They go to zero, but not fast enough because there's only. So there's a expanding annulus around them. So that means the color grows like log of something like that, a log of t or log of So this is a asymptotic to one over Qn I times the intersection of gamma with mu i. Okay, so that you can show easily. So there are four. So I will write what you get is that if you have two curves like that. So Tn, they are balanced times of alpha I n. Okay. The hyperbolic length of gamma over the times Tn over the hyperbolic length of gamma prime is something like, okay, so you have this log of I mu and I intersection mu and I and here you have same thing. For the intersection is gamma prime. Okay? So this is kind of what the picture that you want. Okay. And so I'll just now tell you what so the idea is to on top of just having these curves alpha n on the three toroid balanced at the same time, you also want that effect. So the length, they can be different, yeah. But I want that the colors are more or less the same. So the the log, if you take the log, then the error is not so bad. So basically, I will also want that log of an plus 1. It's about the same as log of 1. So I will want that, and I will tell you now which and what I want. And I want that this Q end U n1, U n2, U n3 is the same as there's a condition. So basically, what helps us do get what we want is that we just make coefficients very, very large. Like, so every every next coefficient is much, much, much larger. Is like bigger than exponential of to the k times, I don't know, so much, much larger than the previous one. Okay. So, so in the paper it's clearly quantified. And then, so, and I take the even ones. So the trajectories are the same as u. So basically this is some sort of so what this implies, can I have one? So what this condition gives you that is what you want. So that the somehow the idea is that some kind of the even ones give you the ratio that you want, and the odd ones compensate, and then you get the ratio that you want, and then you compensate, and then it's on. That's how you can do it. But yeah, so it's kind of technical. But yeah, so basically, this implies. This implies that, okay, so this q to n plus 1, so the odd q's They are all equal. And the even ones. They give you the ratio that you want. So they give you the ratio that you want, and finally, maybe I forgot the condition. But basically, you can also get that the logs are the logs are about the same. The logs of the A of the odd A's. And then it works. So yeah. So sorry, I wanted to talk about minimal case, but yeah, I just wanted to give an idea of how this works.
More complicated than the simplex.
Yeah, so the I don't know examples of so there's a paper by Chris Leininger, Babak, Jabrok, Babak Manami and Chris Kazarafi. So basically they have some examples of minimal non-nucleogodic foliations, and there within their construction some conditions where the limit set is a simple closed curve. So like the you know so the
boundary of the simple.
But yeah. So
but if you just try to get a subset, complex subset or something of the simplex, did you do it with your method or not? Choose your UI on that.
Yeah, so what I should, so as you notice, like I pick a sequence. I give you a sequence where what I want happens.
Yes.
Exactly. I have no idea what happens outside of that sequence. So it isn't. I mean, okay. So it's a lot. I mean, yeah. It is not trivial.
But do you know it stays in the simplex?
I know it stays in the simplex. Yeah. So yeah. So there is another work is to. So you have this surface of Yeah, so you kind of, so what else can happen is that maybe the foliation in the limit grew some cylinders. Like you have these three curves here. But maybe like there is some weight on these three curves. Okay. So you have to show that it does not happen. But it's not very complicated. And then in the higher dimensional case, you have like a D plus one. You have a sphere with d plus one components, so in general something can happen because there are more curves. So you also, yeah, so it is, you need to show that.
Is it possible that for every foliation you could come up with a type noise you use it that converge to the full simplex of measures on that foliation? Or is there some example known that you can't do that?
Well, I mean, if you take a...
Oh, okay, so maybe I should say there are no cylinders then.
If you just take cylinders.
So what if I say there are no cylinders?
So yeah, actually I never worked it out, but for example, there are no cylinders. If there are cylinders, then I have a suspicion that cylinders die. If there is like a minimal component and a cylinder, I did not work it out, but I think that cylinder must die. So, I don't know. I wanted to mention that. No, but I don't think it is known.
Yeah, so is it always the case that when you take the limit of such a minimal non-unitary logarithmic foliation, you get always the same topological foliation in the limit?
Yeah.
That's nice. Yes.
But that's also not me.
If there are no further questions.